Hey, thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. We have prayed that you'd be blessed by it. We want you to know, too, we believe that this is really supplemental to your experience in the life of a local church. But if you're here in the Dallas area, we hope you'll come and join us and be with us for worship. We pray this blesses your life and you're drawn closer to Christ as a result of this message. Last week, we really introduced a new series of messages. So if you're new here today or weren't here last week, you're not too far behind. We're calling it Inside Voice. And last week, I mentioned that I made a new friend over the holidays. I saw her again this week. And she told me, as we were talking about our common love for the arts, for music and for visual arts, she said that she experiences this thing called synesthesia. You might remember I talked about this last week if you were here. Synesthesia is something I'd never heard about. So I was kind of intrigued, and then I started to study it a little bit. I went back and told her that, hey, I used you in a sermon illustration. And she's like, wow, and that's kind of, wow. And I explained why. I mean, it's kind of cool. You know, being a pastor gives you kind of a segue into spiritual conversations a lot when people ask me what I do. And I can tell almost immediately, you know, like, well, I'm a pastor in a church. And you either get this kind of eager, wow, you know, tell me more. Or it's like, oh, wow, okay, good. All right, thanks. So anyway, it's been fun. Synesthesia is this thing that she explains. There's different types of it, but when she hears music, she sees color. And what I've learned, it's kind of like perfect pitch, but so perfect, so aware of music, that when you hear music in certain keys, then presents certain colors. And she can tell what key a song is in or what is being played by the color that she sees. I did it again this week. I said, like, so what are you hearing? I mean, what are you seeing right now? What's happening today? What's going on? She said, well, it's kind of orange right now. Everything's a little bit orange. I said, cool, orange. All right. What's that mean? Oh, this is a key of A. It's in A. This song's in A. It's like, what? You know? And so there's this whole, it's a completely different dimension where she is so aware of music. So she doesn't just hear it, but she sees it. And I've thought this is kind of an apt analogy of a spirit-filled life is what the Bible talks about, where we not only hear God's word as you're hearing today, or we read it and we see it, we hear it from his word, but we see it. And what I mean is we see then God differently, we see ourselves differently, and we see the world differently. We see others differently. We lead with love and grace instead of judgment and comparison and all those things. What a freeing way to live. And only the gospel does that. Only the good news of Christ does that. And so we're asking the questions in this month, you know, what does it mean to walk in the Spirit of God? I like what Paul says. He says to keep in step with the Spirit. What does it mean to be a Christian who is filled with the Spirit, who's constantly aware of not just hearing God speak to us, but seeing the world in a different way? How do we live that way as we seek to follow Jesus every day? I guess simply put today, here it is. What does it mean to have the mind of Christ? And so what I want you to do is go ahead and turn in your Bible to the book of John, all right? And we're going to land there here in a moment. A couple of verses, passages I want to look at. John 14 is where we're going to start. We're looking at the upper room discourse. And this is a fancy, I guess, term used by theologians and biblical types to say this is where Jesus is speaking to his disciples in the upper room. He's about to go to the cross the next day. So he's about to end the kind of the Passover meal, which would be the first Lord's Supper is what we call it. He's going to be arrested. He's going to be beaten almost to death. He's going to be taken upon a cross. And then he's going to spend much of Friday on a cross and die by 3:00. And Jesus knows this is coming. And so now he's speaking. And here's what's interesting. In his final words, long discourse of teaching, we have here in this portion of the book of John, most of what he talks about is the Spirit that will come. Because he's bringing comfort to his friends, his closest friends, and he says, it's going to be to your advantage, I promise. I mean, there must have been this ominous kind of weight in the room that night. And Jesus is saying, listen, I'm going to leave you guys. But don't be discouraged. I must leave because if I leave, I'm going to send the Spirit. And then greater things are you going to do than I've done. And so here's what happens. We could say it this way. You know that Jesus how about this? The Spirit in you is better than Jesus beside you. You know, it's one thing to be with. It's another thing to be in. That's a connection altogether greater. I've said it this way, that you know, the Spirit of God in you, He's closer to you than your own heartbeat. He's nearer to you than your own skin. And this, again, this is a spiritual dimension. This is another way to live. And so Jesus is teaching us, and he's going to challenge us here to what it means to have the mind of Christ. Now look at what he says in John chapter 14. John 14, verses 25, 26. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. So they're getting this sense. Wait. What do you mean? What are you talking about? You're not going anywhere, right? You're 33 years old. You're not leaving us. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you. I love this. Hey, let's pray again. Lord God, I pray that you'll take your word and by your Spirit now speak into our hearts, that we receive it gladly, ready to apply it and ready to obey. We ask, God, that you transform our hearts. Only you can do that. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, so back in the day, I studied a lot of philosophy and love philosophy. And I remember studying Rene Descartes. He's a French philosopher. You've heard of him, perhaps. He's the one who said, cogito ergo sum, which in Latin means, I think, therefore I am. Now, it's really interesting that he would argue that we know that we exist. I don't know if anybody here today is wondering, I wonder if I exist or not, right? But he argued in this great moment of philosophical doubt, he would say, well, we know this. We know that we exist because we're thinking. I have a thought, so if there's a thought, there must be a thinker. But what he's saying basically is the base primal level of existence is a thought in the mind. Now, I don't know exactly, you know, if we really need all the help from him about that. You know, I doubt that I exist, but now I'm thinking, so I must exist. I'm not sure that many of us really live in that realm now. But, you know, the Bible says long before that in Proverbs 23:7, it says, as a man thinks, so is he. It was Ralph Waldo Emerson who said, if you sow a thought, you reap, you heard this? An action. If you sow an action, you reap a habit. If you sow a habit, you reap a character. And he said, if you reap or sow a character, then you reap a destiny. Meaning a foregone kind of conclusion or point that you're gonna end up at. And it all starts in the mind. And young people, listen, this is so important for us to understand. People who are older like me can look back on our lives and we can see mistakes that we made and things that we did that we still struggle with. Maybe it is, God forgiven me, or you know, stories, part of our stories that really continue to wear us down because of mistakes and things that we did in the past. And it all started in the mind. And we all know this, right? Every action that you, every word that you speak begins in the mind. And so if you can grasp what I want to share today, this is so important. As if we can understand what it means to have the mind of Christ, it will change your entire life. And if you don't know Christ, or you're still trying to figure out what it means to follow Christ, I want you to listen in. Because you know it's true that everything starts, if you know Descartes was right, the primal level of life begins in the mind. And so if we can learn to have the mind of Christ, it changes everything about us. All right? So here's what I want us to look at today. The Spirit of Truth. Look at what it says. You can keep your scripture, your Bible open there in John 14, because he says that the Helper, the Holy Spirit, all right, is going to come to you. This is the Spirit of Truth. And here's what the Spirit, he says that he's going to be a helper and he's going to do two things, all right? First, he's going to help, he helps us get it, all right? Now, you understand some of the language here. Get what? Get the truth. Truth about who you are, the truth about who God is, the truth about life. This is what we see here. The Spirit teaches, he directs, he admonishes. So how do we get it? God speaks primarily through his word, all right? So don't miss this. The Spirit of Truth matches up with the word of God. How do you know what I'm thinking right now? Well, you're hearing me speak, right? So we know the mind of God because of the word of God and the words of God. How do you know the thinking of anyone? How do you know what anyone's thinking? You know by what they say and by what they do. So we know God because of what he says, what he does, and what he has done. But here's what's interesting in our day. And this is a major shift for us here at Park City Baptist Church. If you've been in other churches, a core principle and truth that we talk about what it means to follow Jesus every day. We you hear us ask the questions often. What is God saying to you? How will you obey? Whom will you tell? What is God saying to you? Because here's what happens in our day with technology, and you can go online and find your favorite preacher and whatever else, or I got to read that latest book from that person, and women's studies, we got to go hear this woman, and then men, I like that guy. And what happens is we can get secondhand servings, right, of truth from other people, even now. I'm not saying this is wrong that someone like myself, who has studied the context, understands the Word of God, gets the original intent of the writer, the original hearers, all of that translated then through much study, through years, and bring that to us to greater understanding. That's important. But what happens, don't miss this, and do you do this? There's a lot of Christians, there's this kind of cult of personality. And I get it that there are certain preachers, types, teachers that you want to hear from, but God's Spirit speaks to you directly. You don't have to get secondhand helpings from someone else. That's a passivity that God never intended in your life. The Spirit of God speaks to you personally. How does he do that? Through his word, primarily. So the question, of course, then challenge, are you in his word? And not to shame anybody, but to challenge you. Are you in his word daily? Because if you believe in, yes, in the safety and the context of this worship service right here, that yes, that's important. God's word, that's why I'm here. I want to learn more about God. Are you in his word daily? Because that is where you're hearing the truth of God. He speaks through his word to you. You don't have to hear it from someone else. He desires to use others, but he wants to speak to you. What is God's Spirit saying to you? That's why I'm asking you throughout this message today, what is God saying to you? You're thinking, well, already, Jeff, thank you very much. The Spirit's convicting me that I need to be in the Word more. He speaks to us through prayer. He speaks to us through the body. So way to go, way to be here today. He speaks through others. You wouldn't be hearing this truth if you were not here. But this is a major shift that I don't need to go and find the latest, seminary trained type. You and I have the greatest seminary instructor living inside of us, the Holy Spirit of God, who helps you get it, all right? But look at what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. You can see it on the screen. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. Now catch his language here. The spiritual person, watch this, two types, natural person, spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. Now what is that? What is he saying? Well, I'm not accountable to anybody. No, listen. Spiritual critics, or how about this? Unspiritual, natural critics who come to you don't have any say in the matter. You're judged by God alone, for who has the mind of the Lord as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. What's Paul saying here? He's saying, hey, the unspiritual person by nature as it is does not understand the spiritual things of God. Without the Spirit of God living in you, you don't have this connection with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. When you receive Christ, you receive the triune God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit then resides in you. But what Paul is saying is this. He says, so if you're not in open communion with the one who is now spiritually alive in you, then you're going to be judged by others, and you're just a natural person seeking to figure out what this life's all about. And then he goes on to say, he asks Isaiah's question, is there anyone around who really knows what God is doing? And then it's as if he goes, Christ does. We have the mind of Christ, is what he says. Look at that. Zechariah 4:6 says, not by might, not by power, but by my, anybody? Spirit, says the Lord. It's by his Spirit that he speaks to us, not by our education in the end, or by our own, he's talking about human power. See, this is this spiritual synesthesia. We hear from the Word of God. It's a new dimension of spiritual awareness. We're aware that the Spirit is at work in our lives all the time. It's communion with this triune God who now comes to reside in us. The Spirit helps us get it. But look at what else he says. And to not forget it. The Spirit helps us get it. And the Spirit helps us not forget it. Did you see that in John 14, 26? If you still have the Bible open there or looking at that. It says, he will bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Notice he says all. Jesus is saying that the Spirit's teaching will be a continuation of his teaching. Again, they're one. And so after the Lord leaves, he says the Spirit's going to come. And I love this. He's going to bring to mind. I could say it this way. He's going to bring to mind and he's going to remind you of what Jesus has already said. How do we know what God desires of us? Well, we know it because of what he's already said to us through Christ and through his word. All of this, you know, begs the question, why does he say, I'm going to teach you, guide you, but I'm also going to help you remember? Well, you say, well, Jeff, because we're prone to forget. We're prone to forget. And over in the Bible, 161 times, you see the word remember, remember, remember. In fact, we have what we call the Lord's Supper, right? We're going to be walking through communion together very soon. And it's all about remembering. And remembering the primary thing, the one thing above all things. And that is that Christ has died on the cross for our sin. He lived the perfect life. He died for us so that we are completely forgiven and totally loved by God, even in our sinful state. He says, remember, remember. So you look in the Bible, if you know the Old Testament, there's stories of the people of God who said, let's build a monument here and remember what God's done. Let's stack up some stones and just build this memorial right here so we can remember and we can tell our children what God has done here. I hope you're doing that in different ways. Those of you who are married or have family, you know, maybe over the Christmas holidays or at certain times, you have ways to mark moments. I know baptism is one of those times. Where we mark the moment and we remember. But all this begs the question, why do we so quickly forget? And here's where I want to kind of talk about a very practical piece of the message here. All right? Always preaching towards application. How can we get it and not forget it? How can we continue to walk with Christ, to have the mind of Christ? Why do we struggle so? Because you and I are the same. We'll find ourselves off on Monday afternoon, Thursday afternoon, and forget completely who we are. And then we start to drift. Well, I want to remind us today, I think it's important to remember what kind of spiritual realm, as we think about this spiritual synesthesia, this other dimension that we've got to constantly be aware of. I want to remind you that we are in a struggle, and it's a spiritual struggle. Look at what it says in Ephesians 6. I'll have it on the screen there. You can turn there if you'd like. But as you continue to take notes and write down and think about what God's saying to you, listen to Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally, he's toward the end of this letter. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes. That word there is strategies, by the way. The strategies of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, he's saying, having done all of this, to stand firm. How do we stand firm? You know, Christianity in the end, if you're kind of new to the church or still trying to understand what the gospel, what the good news of Jesus is all about, Christianity is not primarily about doing this and not doing that. It's instead having the Lord change our desires by his Spirit for this and not that. You see, the person who walks in the Spirit has different desires. And as we've already sung about today, ultimately, when we have the superior satisfaction or desire than satisfaction found in Christ, then he becomes the one thing. Our one pursuit, our pure and holy passion is Christ himself. It's why he would say in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Everything else will fall into place. The reason that you are so stressed and worried and busy, The reason that you are considering everyone's opinion and approval or your performance, the reason your life is a roller coaster is because you are not pursuing one pure and holy passion. And until you do, friends, listen, until you find this superior satisfaction in Christ, you will always be seeking, always be searching. It's why we've got to stay in the Word. But I want to remind you today that it is possible to have the mind of Christ. You say, well, how do I get it? Listen. If you're a believer, you already have it. If you're a believer, you already have the Spirit in you. So Paul admonishes us. He challenges us. Be filled with the Spirit. You say, well, how do I? Don't I have the Spirit? Am I not filled? There's varying degrees of being filled with the Spirit. And it has all to do with a focus on Christ and what he's done. But you know, here's what happens. Here in Dallas, this is why I wanted to just add this parenthetically to some teaching here this morning. In the global West, we don't like to talk about the spiritual realm. We don't talk about evil. We talk about other instances or reasons as to why things are the way they are. We don't talk about evil. In fact, you know, it actually comes into play in the news recently. Don Lemon, he's a CNN reporter. He was hosting a group interview after the horrific abuse of the mentally disabled teenager. Maybe you saw that story a couple weeks ago. And in one of the interviewees, he's a journalist, Matt Lewis. He said, I'll tell you what went on there. He said, that was evil, is what that was. That was evil, what those young people did to him. And then Don Lemon followed that. And he says, I don't think it's evil. No, that wasn't evil. It was just bad home training is what that was. These young people, they're teenagers. They have had bad home training. Listen, we don't want to talk about evil. There's always a psychological reason. Poor education. No, they just had bad home training. You know, Governor Rick Scott, he's the governor of Florida. He made news when he said that the shooting in Fort Lauderdale in the airport, he said, that was a senseless evil is what that was. And it's why other political types or people in public leadership, they won't talk about evil. And here's why. Because they know, if not just intuitively, if you talk about evil, you're talking about another force. You're talking about a spiritual force. And if you're talking about evil, then there must be a source of evil, right? And if there's a source of evil, how about this? There's got to be a source of good. I had this conversation with someone this week. When you talk about evil and suffering in the world, I'm saying, well, why should it be any different? What are you saying? You're saying there's bad? And if there's bad, then there's good, right? And if there's good, if there's moral goodness, then there is a supreme good. Good is not simply evolutionary, you know, possibilities along the way that have led us to this moral state. C.S. Lewis offered the great moral argument for the existence of God. The fact that we all know there's good and evil. And so we don't want to go there though, right? If we talk about evil, then you've got to talk about supreme good ultimately. And then if there's good, then there's God. Now you are accountable. We don't want to go there. In fact, some of you may have read the book or maybe seen the movie sometime later. Thomas Harris wrote the novel, The Silence of the Lambs. And in it, he has this serial killer. Hannibal Lecter is the main antagonist in the story. And he's a psycho. And there's a point at which he's been captured. He's been caught after, anyway, you know, if you've seen the movie, it's Anthony Hopkins, right? If you've seen the film from years ago. But there's a moment where this young officer, woman officer, Detective Starling, has him across the table. And she's interrogating him, just questioning him. And it comes to a point where she's so intrigued by this guy because he's brilliant. And she says to him, what happened to you? What happened to you? Meaning, what are the psychosociological factors that came into play to make you who you are? And then here's what the antagonist says, this evil Hannibal Lecter, he says, I happened. He says, you can't reduce me to a set of influences. You've given up good and evil for behaviorism. You've got everybody in moral dignity pants. Nothing is ever anybody's fault. See, in this case, the antagonist is saying what others are unwilling to say. He's saying, I'm evil. There's a force outside of me that has come into play, and you cannot explain it by simple sociological forces. Now, that's an extreme, kind of unsettling example. But friend, listen, what I'm trying to do is help you see that there is an evil force in the world. And it is at work. Satan is roaming the earth like a lion. There are demonic forces in the world that are seeking to take you down. And many sophisticated, educated people in North Dallas would say to me, Jeff, come on, you're being too simplistic. Come on. Maybe for the uneducated. Because here's the truth. When I go to other places around the world, some of you have done this, whether it be India or Africa, parts of Africa, I've seen face-to-face witch doctors, demonic possession. I've seen it. I could tell stories. We were in Cuba not long ago, Stacy and I, and we're walking in Havana. We were in another Camagüey, perhaps. We heard a parade that was taking place. We're with others who were there from Cuba, obviously, and Luis, one of our friends who's a member here, we're there. He grew up, and he started to get kind of freaked out a little bit. And he said, this is not good. And there was this parade that was coming with music, and it was this celebration of, you perhaps have heard, Santeria. It's kind of this worship of the dead. And these people came, and they were painted up and all this kind of stuff. But it's basically a demonic worship of evil forces. And this is one of many places where I've been in the world where I have sensed and seen tangibly the oppression of the spirit upon a people. And Luis got so freaked out, he said, We've got to go. We gotta leave. This is not good. We gotta leave. We gotta go. And what happens is we see that and we go, well, yeah, you know, they're not quite educated enough. Really? Are we gonna be so prideful that we think that, see, people around the world, places all over, the Middle East, across the East, into South America, Central America, into Africa, when they understand, because they do, they see the world and spiritual forces at work, good and evil forces in the world, and it helps them make sense of life. Instead, we want to say, well, you know, better education probably fix that. Friends, listen. We need to come to understand, be mindful of the battle that we find ourselves in. See, C.S. Lewis, again, was one who said, there's two errors. He said this at the beginning of Screwtape Letters. Two errors. One is to, you know, find Satan under every rock. Those are my words, not his. And the other is not, you know, just disregard him altogether. Because some of you are here today and you might think, well, man, you know, and some Christians do this. Like, wow, you're angry. That's satanic. No, you just need to get a grip on your anger. You know? You've got this unforgiving spirit. That's a moral issue. You just need to be willing to forgive. Now, that's a gospel issue. I get that. But it's not unlike what one author said. He wrote a book called Healthy Emotional Spirituality. He said, Jesus may be in your heart, but granddaddy's in your bones. And you got stuff you need to work on. But the other is to disregard him altogether. You see, because here's what happens. The devil attacks us in really two ways. Temptation and accusation. Temptation is Satan wanting you to think too highly of yourself. That God's not enough. It's a reduction of his holiness. It's the oldest lie from the garden. Did God really say? See, he tempts us, making us think more highly of ourselves. And he accuses us. We've talked about this recently. Accusation is to make you think less of yourself. That God wouldn't love you because of who you are, what you've done. And see, this is why the gospel is so powerful. Only in the gospel do we find ourselves, like Paul, I can say, I'm the chief of sinners. And at the same time, I'm completely loved, totally accepted by God. Because of Christ. Then that love motivates me. But see, here's what we do. We don't understand that this this evil force in the world, spiritual forces come into our minds first to get us to think things that will lead then to action. How do these lies come? Well, one of those lies, short-term pleasure up against long-term consequences. You know that one, right? I mean, that's just base 101 temptation. And Satan speaks into your life. And here's what we do. We start to, we enter into self-talk instead of spirit talk. This is why the Bible is so important. By what you're doing right now is so important. Because what we do, we end up saying, hey, I'm not greedy, I'm just thrifty. I'm not nosy, I'm just concerned. I'm not an alcoholic, I'm just sociable. You need to relax a little bit. When I've confronted men who've had affairs, I've talked to, ministers who've fallen into adultery. And the common theme, Jeff, I got to a place where I felt like I deserved this. I worked so hard in all these other areas of my life, and I was all good everywhere else, but I just had this little pleasure. Friends, listen, you don't believe that's a satanic attack, bringing people down, and all of us have particular sins that we're bent towards. Here's what it is in the end. I don't have enough. I don't have enough. Back to that superior satisfaction we find in Christ. He alone is the answer. So in John 16, I'll close with this. John 16, verses 12 through 15. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. He's saying to his disciples. When the Spirit of truth comes, and now he has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. And he will glorify me. I love that. For he will take what is mine and declare it to you, all that the Father has is mine. Therefore I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. See, the Spirit will glorify Jesus. He teaches us, he reminds us, and then he glorifies the Son. Here's something we say often around here. Ask the Spirit of God to use the Word of God to show you the Son of God. That's what it's all about in your daily walk with Christ, because Jesus says this in John 8. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, then you're truly my disciples. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And then he said in John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So I could say it this way. The Spirit of truth helps us get him and not forget him. What he's done for us upon the cross. And so here's what I want to challenge you to do as we land. You don't do this alone. You do it with God's word, but you do it in community. And so this month, we're really talking a lot about getting plugged in to a connect group. It's one thing to come to worship. It's another thing to get in a group. So you've received a piece that could help you. You can see on our website, you can go to a link on our website that'll help you as well to find the connect group that's one that's just right for you. We want to help you do that today. You can go into the commons and find a place. Because here's what I'd close with today. Here's my great hope for you. Through worship, through his word, I think what the Spirit wants us to do, and this is a word for someone here, look less at your sin and look more at your Savior. Look less at your sin and more at your Savior. In Colossians 3, 1 through 3, it says this, if then you've been raised up with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things of the earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in him. The Spirit helps us get it and not forget it. The Spirit helps us get him and not forget him and what he's done for us. Praise be to God for Jesus Christ, our Savior. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for your word and how it teaches us. We thank you that you are such a great and mighty God. And so we want to worship you with our lives, Lord. I think after a teaching like this, we're more aware, but we want to do something. We want to say yes to you. So friend, listen, if you are here and you've never entered into this spiritual dimension, you do so by receiving Christ, by faith. It's not by works. It's not by your own thinking or education. It's not even by spiritual education or knowledge of the Bible as much as it is knowledge of what Christ has done for us. He's died on the cross for your sin. He's done all that's necessary for you. He's lived the perfect life on your behalf. Receive His grace. Say yes to Him. Thank you, Lord, for dying on the cross for me. I receive your forgiveness. I give you my life. For so many who have done that, just ask Him, Lord, I'm sorry. Would you forgive me? And thank you that on the cross you have, and I can enter into now this fellowship of grace with you. Thank you for how you've made a way. I give you my life anew today. Give me one great superior satisfaction in life. We give you our lives, Lord. We worship you. We praise you. In your name we pray.
Thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. If you would like more information about our church or following Jesus, please go to our website, pcbc.org, or contact our church offices. We hope to see you next week at church.